What's up, bros? Welcome to another BroGraph Brocast. I am Dave Koss.
And I am Matt Milstead.
And we have a good show for you this week. We've got more stuff than we thought we would, as usual.
As always.
So we'll get right into it. If you don't know what the show is about and you're brand new, thanks for tuning in. I know there's a lot of new listeners out there right now. And so I would just like to personally say welcome.
Thank you for all your support. We love each and every one of you.
And this show is about motion graphics, as you might have imagined, and it's about Cinema 4D, After Effects. It's a supplement to the site brograph.com, where we have motion graphics tutorials and experiments and soon plugins and whatnot. But we also kind of get a little bit deeper into the old topics like office stuff and business stuff and like super nerdy details that maybe only make sense to nerd out to when you're listening to it.
Not sometimes it doesn't even make sense to me.
Yeah. Yeah. I know some of those words. And then we also will sometimes just get off on random other topics that have nothing to do with motion graphics whatsoever.
So. It's a good collaboration of a whole bunch of organized nonsense.
So I sure hope you like rat holes, because there's plenty of them.
Yep.
Plenty of them.
Full of rat holes.
So this week, like we were talking about, we got a lot of new listeners. There's subscriptions. The subscriptions are up.
Mm-hmm. A lot.
Way up. It's good.
Yeah. Well, this is the, I believe, fifth week in a row that we have beaten the previous week.
Yeah, so that's good. The numbers are going up. Thanks for telling all of your friends. We really like that.
Yep. The rule number one of Brocast, tell all your friends about Brocast.
That's true. So what we usually do at the beginning is we will go through like what's happened in the week and stuff. So we'll start off with that. The Craptacular Turd Polishing Contest. This is something that
is still happening.
Well, this is something we need to revisit because it kind of fizzled because a whole bunch of stuff happened. And And partially because we started talking about like a collaboration on Reddit with it, and that kind of fizzled out. So we're going to revisit that. Haven't forgotten about it. We're not doing it right away, but just I haven't forgotten about it. It's on that list and whatnot. So
did someone email us about that?
No. I've just had it on the list for a while, and I thought if people are listening and they wondered what happened to it, that I would just bring it up and say, we haven't forgotten it. There's a lot of stuff that just happens slower than planned, including DFW C4D. We've got some more people signed up for it. We were hoping for early spring. It looks like it's going to be a little later because we are finishing the plug-in. That's that's number one. We've got a lot of work, and I'm heading out of town, so we're going to get to it as soon as we can.
Yeah, Dave needs to go to Iceland first.
Yes, for research.
Research.
Yeah, no. The other thing is that I wanted to talk to Already Been Chewed, because there's a possibility that they'll be involved in this event, and I wanted time to sit and kind of collaborate before we do anything, and we just hadn't had time to talk to them yet.
Yep.
So keep that up. Keep looking at dfwc4d.com. You can sign up there if you want updates. If you're gonna, if you would like to come out, if you're near Dallas, Fort Worth, and would like to check that out,
or if you just want to fly all the way from like say like New Zealand to Dallas, you know, feel free.
Yeah, yeah.
We'll let you know when.
All right. So here's some random stuff from this week. Is there a shortcut to open Premiere without it opening the last project you open? That's a question I have.
I don't think it ever opens the last project. When I open Premiere, yours comes up. No, it comes up with the what do you want to open box.
Oh, well, this is one of those things where like I could easily Google the answer, but I was just thinking about it. Because you know what I don't like about Premiere is the stupid... what is it?
That anytime you open up a new project, it doesn't just open up everything like Final Cut did. It makes you start a new project and save it first before you can even start working. That's my least favorite thing.
No, it's mainly like the conforming media thing that drives me nuts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's awful. Well, you can also unclick There's like an option to unclick, make, generate the peak lines for your audio or something. That always takes forever for me, especially when you've got like a, when you're working on like a full length documentary or something, like a 90 minute documentary, and you've got to go through and you've got to build all those audio waveforms. Oh, yeah, it's totally awful. But you, well, there's actually a click button in there that you can turn off.
Yeah, I think I know of that, and that's really not the problem I have, but it's conforming. Because if you go through and you clear your cache, and then you go open a project you haven't opened in a while, then it has to sit there and conform all that garbage again. And it's just like,
yeah,
really?
Well, I mean, I think it's like a give and take with Premiere. You know, you couldn't bring in every single different type of file. Like, that's the real advantage of Premiere, is that you can throw anything at it and it'll open it. Like, I wish wasn't it just the other day you were asking me about, what was it? The .ts. Yeah, .ts files, which are, you know, DVD streams or whatever. Threw it into Premiere, it worked fine.
Yeah, because I've dropped it into Premiere and it said, do you want to download this codec? And you say yes, and then it... it does it in Premiere and just says, okay, now we can view this.
Yeah, super cool.
You're good. It's really the fact that if you have sequences that aren't open, it's trying to conform those sequences that aren't open. So case in point, when I post this show, I post this show on YouTube and on Vimeo just for people who like to use that instead.
Yeah.
And, you know, we only have, I don't know, like 50 to 100 people who watch those streams in particular, but they're out there.
Listen.
And, you know, people actually use them, though. I mean, people have discovered us on that. So, you know, it's one of those things where I like to put it out there, but then when I open the program, because these MP3s are so long, it ends up doing, like, this big, like, conform thing. And if I'm dumping my cache, then every week when I open it up to do the show, it's trying to conform, like, 30-something, 2.5-hour long files.
That's awesome.
So I don't know. Anyway, it's whatever.
It's whatever.
It's whatever. It's just one of those things that popped in my head and I wrote it on there.
Yeah.
So also this week we started working, collaborating with David. Are you going to the mall later today? We started working with him on a couple different projects, but one in particular is a Zika project.
Zika virus? Can we talk about it? We're not under NDA, are we?
No, I asked him before the show. Okay. We can talk about this.
Sweet.
We're not going to go into too much detail on it, but it's kind of fun because, you know, we've been hanging out and stuff and like broing out and talking about motion graphics and whatnot and Skyping, and he's been on the show and we hung out in Vegas and now we're actually working together on a project. So that's a lot of fun. We're
actually and he did the tutorial for us, you know?
Yeah. First tutorial on what was it called?
Mocha Pro.
I keep forgetting the name of it. It's
Mocha Import Pro, I believe.
Import. I thought it had the word Express in it. You think we would know?
Mocha Import Express Pro Video Niner.
Niner.
Oh, Mocha Import Plus. Yeah.
Mocha Import Plus. So, so he did that. And that was nice. It's kind of like his first bro tutorial.
Oh,
that's how he coined it. In the video. Oh, you didn't watch it, did you?
No, I did. I watched like half of it, I think.
And so it's good. He talks about how to track. It's really cool because he has some footage that he got permission to use, where he's tracking some stuff. It's like how to do removal or add things onto existing footage, and how you can stabilize and kind of remove or do your thing.
Yeah,
and
it's super cool.
Unstabilize. Like,
it basically creates it takes your footage, puts it in a pre-comp that is stabilized, so you don't have to go through and motion track all the stuff that you're adding or deleting. Pretty cool. Very cool, actually.
Yeah. And so we're working together this week, and we used the plugin that Sarah told us about. The
D-U-I-K.
Duik. Duik, the 2D animation IK chain deal for After Effects.
This is the absolute coolest thing. I wish I had looked into it more before last week. That way we could have talked about it. But, like, it is a way cool plugin. You know, well, and it's something that I've actually been looking for a really long time, a way to easily create IK chains in After Effects.
We should have more to talk about it next week because we're going to be digging into it a lot this week. So,
well, I mean, just from the tutorial that I saw, if you name all your layers correctly, whether it be in Photoshop or Illustrator, it will automatically rig a character for you. IK chain, which is way cool.
Mm-hmm. So we've got, we're mixing a lot of different styles in here.
Yeah, yeah. We're doing the, you know, it's the standard 2D vector explainer type video with some EJ Hassenfrost, you know, style cartoon shaders and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's not all, it's actually mostly 2D stuff. It's not all that, you know, EJ Sassafras style. Sassafras. EJ Sassafras, is that how you say it?
I guess.
Yeah. we had somebody actually design the vector artwork for us. Mm-hmm. And because.
Really cool guy. Actually, the same guy who the one where I did creating IK chains for the 2D characters, Nick Eckel, the guy who designed that image that I used on that tutorial, he's the one doing all of our artwork.
Yeah.
Really great artist. One of the best that I've ever seen.
It's one of those things where it's not that we couldn't do this artwork ourselves, but not being like always in Illustrator, it always makes it that much harder, and it's just easier to say, okay, we need you to design these pieces of art for us so that we can quickly get on to what we have to do, because we have a very short window.
Yeah.
And you know, it's like
he's able to knock out like really awesome looking artwork in a fraction of the time that it would have taken us.
Right. And it's good to be able to say, no, I probably can do this, but should I do this? No, I shouldn't. You know, and say, here's a person who's really fast at it. It would be just, you know, the opposite. I'm sure if this guy needed 3D work done and he was capable, he may come to us and say, well, I need you guys to do it because you're faster.
Yeah.
You know, because we're in it every single day. I'm not an illustrator every day.
Nope.
No, maybe once a week.
Yeah.
Something like that. So we're mixing the 2D art, and we're doing a couple of the elements in that Sassafras style. And
pause for laughter.
Yes, yes. I will wait for you to approve of my wrong name for EJ. But speaking of which, EJ, we were talking to him this week. He's going to be on the show soon, possibly as early as next week.
Yeah,
we figured that out. We might do one of those things where we record at a different hour and then just have them on, you know, just play the segment or something like that.
Yeah.
Next week. We're also going to collaborate with him on some tutorials.
Sweet.
So this is actually a really interesting concept. I forget the phrase he coined, like what this is called, but it's where you bounce tutorials off of each other.
I don't know.
Somebody will do part of it, and then somebody will do another part of it, or something to that effect.
Yeah.
Or it could be like a long series. You know, we might come up with, like, somebody records something, and then somebody motion tracks it, and then somebody does something in 3D, and then EJ, like, does something with a cartoon character done with cell shading on it, or something like that. You know, so where you can learn how to do all these different things, and you learn them from different people.
Mm-hmm.
So that could be fun.
Yeah, totally.
And kind of
like how it really works in the industry when you're working collaborating with a team.
Exactly. You've got different people in different areas who are good at what they do, and so you just let them do their thing.
Mm-hmm.
But he posted a new logo for.
Oh my gosh, I love the new logo.
It was so funny. So. We didn't talk about it last week, but this is kind of a design thing. Instagram came up with a new logo.
And it's so funny because, like, you know, my apps on my phone automatically update. And I set them to auto update. And so I'm looking for Instagram and I don't see it. I see this new logo and I'm like, what? They changed their logo. You know, and then, like you do, you know, you switch from one app to the next. And then I go over to, I immediately go over to Twitter after that and see EJ has posted his, and says, I guess it was a bad day to change my logo or something like that. And it looks almost verbatim the Instagram logo.
But that was all on purpose.
Yeah, of course.
And he actually commented that it's funny because a lot of people didn't get that joke. Because the whole thing with the Instagram logo, if you haven't seen it, is it's just this weird mixed color gradient thing.
Yeah.
That's super
simple. Designed
super
by Brent Rambo, apparently.
Yes. And it's like, everybody's giving them flack because it's like, wow, like it took all of this work just to use the gradient tool in Photoshop. And, you know, it's super simple. And so his logo looks like that. And people were like, not getting the joke, but whatever. Nick Campbell retweeted something about that where he said, not Nick himself, but the guy he retweeted said something about, you know, rebranding is, I can't remember. Rebranding is more work than you think.
Yeah.
All that. And it's like, okay, yeah, I get that. I mean, let's look at Starbucks' new cup from last year.
But I will say, like, Instagram, I mean, they did a pretty good job of it, you know, with the new logo and stuff like that, because a lot of attention was brought to it. I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I think they were quite successful in the rebranding image, I guess.
Yeah. I don't necessarily hate it. I don't like it either. It's just kind of like,
it's definitely much more up to date than their previous one.
Well, you know? That's true. That's true, because everybody's moving to flat, and they've been at that for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know.
Yeah, the new app is nice. The new layout is nice.
I don't even know if I've looked at it yet. I updated, but I don't think I've looked at it.
Yeah. No, you're not an Instagram guy.
I'm trying to be.
Are you?
Yeah.
I follow you. I mean, you don't post anything.
I do. It's not... I mean, it's maybe once every week or once every 2 weeks, but I do. Because they have a really cool thing in there where you can get a book of all the pictures that you took.
Yeah.
For, what is it, like $6.99 every time you take 80 pictures?
I don't know. Amy's done that a few times.
Yeah, it's a pretty cool little deal. Mm-hmm. I really want to do that, but I can't. I haven't taken enough pictures.
Taken enough pictures to fill a book.
Yeah. And then the guys who make Mocha, which is...
Imagineer Systems, I think it is.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. They actually want David to do more stuff on Mocha.
Oh, yeah. So maybe we'll be doing some more stuff on Mocha.
Yeah.
So I like Mocha. Mocha was a great addition to the After Effects.
Oh, man. Sweet. 2D tracking is just phenomenal. Mm-hmm. It's so easy.
Totally.
Yeah. Plugin update. Plugin update. Still behind, trying to get beta 6 going. I'm working on it. Just hang in there. I know there's some things that need to be fixed. We should hopefully be getting on our way tomorrow. I'm trying to spend at least an hour a day on it in order to get it out.
And, you know, it's Sunday night. The Octane.
The eve of Octane.
Eve of Octane. Yeah. Octane, which my Cinema 4D crashed on me tonight while I was playing around, and I restarted it. I'm in the alpha or the beta version 3 and started it up, and it said cannot connect to the server because they're running maintenance apparently on the license server. Right. So because I did that, I now cannot run Octane at all until they get it back up and running, which sucks.
Yeah, because the version 2 will not validate because of the server. And shout out to Paul, who, you know, I was in the Skype Octane render group thingy, and basically it's just the fact that we did not receive emails about the planned maintenance.
Yeah.
Which we both checked our spam and...
Yeah, nothing.
Nothing. Ask David. But apparently it's not going to be for long.
Yeah, it's supposed to only be a couple hours.
Yeah, so
but
that's
I've heard that before when getting my power back on.
Yeah, right.
Turned out to be days.
Well, we'll just take that as a good sign that they're about to do their
release. Hopefully that means that they will actually release it tomorrow.
Yeah.
So hopefully, because if not, then I can't use Octane at all.
Yeah, that's not going to be very good because we actually have work to do tomorrow.
Yeah.
But on another front, Houdini, we bought Houdini Indy this week and bought two copies, actually.
Uh-huh. One for each of us.
Yeah.
We haven't messed with it yet. Well, I opened it. I opened it. Haven't done much more.
Yeah, I played with it a little bit. I did the Pyro Explosion Shader tutorial.
Okay. Cool. I don't know. I haven't, I watched through a couple of tutorials, but I didn't actually do any of them.
Here's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to figure out, because I would love to do a tutorial on it. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to figure out how to do like a pyro thing and then take that into, to export a VDB file, bring that into Octane 3, shade that, render that.
Okay.
That's what I'm
There's got to be do. A way.
Oh, I'm I mean, sure
with
there's
the new
a way.
Houdini integration into Cinema 4D, like, that's the coolest thing that I have seen about this. This was what totally made me want to buy Houdini. And the indie license, it's only $200, which is awesome. You know, that's a really, that's like a steal for a program like this. But like, it's cool because you can basically build all these, it's almost like plugins, you know, based around the Houdini engine, and then import them in, and you set which parameters you want to be able to adjust in Cinema 4D, you know, kind of like the user data on your Espresso and stuff. So you can go through and you can change that, and you can have that change all you want in Cinema 4D. It's way cool. Way cool.
Yeah.
Once I get that all figured out,
there's no will be great. Like workflow tutorial. I mean, there's probably a couple, but there's no like workflow tutorials going from like starting in Houdini, going through the process, creating the whatchamacallit, or what is that called again? The
VDB?
No.
Pyro Explosion Shader?
No, the you create a whatchamacallit that goes from...
Oh, like it's like an encapsulated, you know, project or something like that. I can't remember. It's like a .hx something niner.
Yeah. It slipped my mind. But you know, I'm sure everybody's yelling it into the radio right now. The thing where you can control all the parameters inside of Cinema 4D.
Yeah.
From inside Houdini. Gosh, it's driving me nuts now. Anyway, I'm under the weather, if I haven't mentioned that. I'm not feeling too great today. So what I would like to be able to do is go through that whole process to where you bring it in, you can control the parameters, especially if it has to do with smoke or fire or any of that stuff that you could integrate into Octane 3.
Totally.
That would be awesome. So, I mean, we're, you know, as we said, we're super slammed right now. There's just a lot going on. So we're hoping to get to that eventually, but we wanted to buy it so we could start looking into it. And thing is, we thought about like trying to float the license between the two of us.
Yeah, because I mean,
it's too much trouble.
Yeah, and they've got a very good licensing thing that'll keep you from doing that. So,
well, it's not like we were trying to. I mean, we weren't trying to.
We weren't trying to pirate it or anything.
Not pirate, but even cheat.
Yeah,
you know. But we wanted to just be able to easily float it.
It would be nice, like. What sucks is that it's node based, you know?
Yeah.
Like, say you've got a laptop that you work off of and, you know, your main computer or whatever. That kind of sucks because what if I want to go work on it on my laptop out, you know, at Starbucks or something? I can't unless I, you know, log into my computer from my other computer. But I was reading on the forums about something and they're like, dude, It's $199.
Yeah.
If you really want another version of it, just buy it for your other computer.
Which is what we did.
Which we do. Yeah. Which is what we ended up doing. So. Yeah.
It's one of those, because you, I'm sure people have installed this type of thing before, where it takes your host ID of your computer, and that's why it's such a pain, because it's not like you can just transfer a number. You have to put something into another thing that like hashes it with an algorithm to the host ID of your computer for a final like number that you then enter in, and you could reverse this whole process and like send the activation back into the server, and then like give it, have it give you the credit back onto your account, and then put it on the other computer. But it's like, oh my gosh, like that's way too much trouble.
The amount of money or the amount of time that you would spend is probably worth about $199.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, all right. So let's talk about Tom Glimpse and his Octane contest.
Yes.
He sent this to us and he was prepping it, I guess yesterday.
Yesterday, I believe.
And was sending us some info, and it's live as of right now.
Yes.
He said we it can is, talk about it.
TomGlimpse.com, TomGlimpse.com/Octane.
I thought it was PSE.
GLIMPS. No, there's no E.
Oh, weird.
Slash Octane dash render dash contest.
Well, either way, it's in the show notes.
It's in the show notes.
Yeah.
So
this is a, well, I guess I'll pull up the site so we can talk about it a little bit.
Yeah, I've got the site up right now. So basically the contest is there was a hand drawn weekend house by Craig Elwood. And basically the contest is to recreate this hand-drawn image in 3D using Octane.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a 6-week contest going on that started today. So you got 5 weeks, 6 days, 13 hours as of the time we're recording this. And so it says that should be enough time to not only make a render, but also learn a thing or two about upcoming version 3 of Octane. And so, and I guess Octane is sponsoring this. Is that correct?
Well, that's what it says. I mean, it says our friends slash sponsors. So I don't know if that means they're a friend or a sponsor.
Right. So, but there's no other friends or sponsors on there. So I'm assuming that they are the sponsors.
Yeah.
But, and now correct me if I'm wrong. It says, the support information says during contest, during... Tom, if you're listening, you should add a "the" during the contest. So, during the contest, for those who enter and already showing some progress, temporary licenses of Octane Render and other packages will be given if you happen to be new and would like to try before you buy, which is really cool. I think that if that means what I think it means that, say, you want to give Octane 3 a try, you know, you can get a temporary license of Octane to enter this contest.
Okay, so all then those, Otoy is probably definitely involved.
They've got to be. Yeah. I mean, that only makes sense to me if they're giving out temporary licenses, because that's super cool, you know. So if you're on the fence about Octane and you want to give it a try, and you know, just I guess the whatchamacallit, the one with the holy cow, the watermarked one just isn't good enough for you, maybe you could try and enter this contest. It's definitely a learning process, and I will tell you, this thing is all Windows, and I've done stuff like this, and it is a pain to light. So
yeah, but you know what? This is the kind of thing that I you know, I just don't have time to do it right now, but I would love to do, because I like doing this for clients. You know, we've gotten stuff. We have a client in particular who works with people who make inventions, and a lot of times they're just sketches, or they come to them and they have them draw a couple CAD things, and and so this is one of those where they'll give me a bunch of sketches and drawings and stuff and say, here, make something 3D out of this. And I really like that part of it, because for me, I enjoy thinking it in my head and then putting it, you know, in like sculpting it into something that feels very realistic with Octane.
Totally.
And so I would love to do something like this because I can see it in my head already. Just looking at this sketch, this mm-hmm. would be really fun to do.
Totally. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, it looks relatively easy as far as, you know, what it looks like, but that's where your imagination can come into play and, you know, really add some fine details and stuff.
Yeah. You can expand on it. It's, mm-hmm. it's a cliff with, kind of a landscape thing going on behind it, and mm-hmm. and there's not much showing as far as the landscape behind it, mm-hmm. And that there's a glass house that goes across, but you mm-hmm. could put more into the background. You know, you could expand upon that. I'm sure people will probably use World Machine in the background, or you know, maybe even take it a step further, make this dystopian.
Oh boy.
Because nobody ever does that,
right?
You know, something like that. So the thing that Tom told us though on Twitter when we were talking was that the users can put their works in progress of these anywhere they want. So mm-hmm. it's not like you're just uploading the work in progress to a whole, you know, like to a site that they have mm-hmm. with all their stuff on it. They actually just let you put it wherever because you get more exposure that way. So Facebook, Twitter,
right.
Instagram, portfolio site, wherever you want is where you put that.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a cool idea because if you have a lot of followers, you can really get it out there and get the contest out there too.
Correct.
You know, do they have a hashtag? Hopefully.
I don't know.
If they don't, they need to. They need to have a hashtag for the contest to put on everything. I'm looking just to see... work in progress. I'm not seeing it offhand, but that would be something really that's something very much needed because then you put that hashtag on everything. Tagging or mentioning Tom on Twitter, but there should be a hashtag,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
So that you could put it, and maybe even if you could put it like
you know on, what, let's make up a hashtag right now.
I don't know if we should do that for him, but yeah, like something where you could actually maybe watermark it onto the image so that people see that hashtag and associate it with the contest, or maybe he wants it to be associated with his site or something. Now, we did talk to Tom about being on the show.
Yes.
That's something that we're also going to work out pretty soon mm-hmm. Because he is the hardware man. If you haven't followed.
Holy cow. Yes. Man. Now, does he work directly with Otoy?
I have no idea.
Because it sure seems like it, the way they interact.
I have no idea. I couldn't. We'll have to ask these questions when he's on.
Yeah, totally.
I know he does listen to the show.
Yeah.
And
what up?
And like the discussions that like we were having about hardware the other day and mm-hmm. and just it was just blowing my mind. It's like I really want to be able to sit and talk to him about like all this crazy stuff. And this, you know, he mentioned stuff too because I talked to him on the Skype Octane channel that mm-hmm. I'm always talking about where I'm talking to guys, and so like there's so much good information, there's so much stuff that's like beyond my comprehension. I sit there and I look at I watch these keynotes that they give, like this GPU conference and the mm-hmm. these announcements that NVIDIA does and all these terms about petaflops and teraflops or whatever they are, you know, and what all this stuff means. And I'm just like, you know, like we said earlier, I know some of those words.
Yeah.
So,
dude, I'm looking at this image that he posted, the 7 GPU rig. That is insane.
Oh, that was freaking beautiful. It scored 1,000 on, is that the one that scored 1,000 on the Octane bench?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
It is 7 Titan X cards.
Now, I was looking at that picture and I can't remember offhand, but are the PCI or whatever they are, the slots, do they have something in them that is routing them out to another box where all the cards are housed?
I have no
or
idea.
Or they, because they don't look like they're in there.
I don't know. It says Titan X on the thing.
Is the Titan X a one slot? See, this is where I know nothing about it. See, this is why he needs to come on and school us.
I know, right?
Because, you know, as it is right now, we know enough to do what we need to do, but we're talking about building some, like, super monster PCs mm-hmm. in the next year or so to really get us going in some of these massive renders that we're doing, and we need to start learning. So,
yeah, totally. Yeah. No, it looks like the Titan X is a dual slot. Man, how big is this machine?
See, that's what I was saying. I was like, it didn't look like there were actually cards in there.
Yeah, I don't know.
So, crazy. The submissions for this, of course, must be made in Octane Render. Mm-hmm. They're going to be made at 4K or A4 size.
Yes.
At 300 DPI.
Yeah. Cool.
So, yeah.
I'm excited to have him on the show.
Yeah, that's going to be an interesting conversation. Mm-hmm. So, we got to figure that out. It's going to be an interesting couple of weeks. We've got Tom. Mm-hmm. We've got EJ. Mm-hmm. And eventually, we're also going to have a new friend we met this week. Hopefully, I have no idea how to pronounce it. Raleigh HL.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Maya guy.
Yeah.
Who we're going to have on.
He uses Maya, mostly Maya and Max, and he, it's so funny. He started messaging us on Facebook while we were, you know, all the three of us were Skyping together. And so I started talking to him and I was like, oh, how'd you find us? Were you listening to the podcast? He goes, oh, you guys run a podcast? I was like, I'm so used to hearing people, you know.
Most people find us from the podcast. Friday, yeah.
Yeah. And he's like, no, I saw your tutorials. Oh, okay. Oh yeah. We do tutorials too, don't we? So I don't know, that's and he's a big character animator, and so character animator in Maya, and he's learning Cinema 4D, so I'm excited. Yeah, that would be pretty cool to have him on the show.
Yeah, and we're actually going to feature him as the artist of the week. Mm-hmm. We do two things. We do the listener artist of the week and we do the artist of the week. The artist of the week is someone we choose. Mm-hmm. It's always of the week, but it's not necessarily every week. Mm-hmm. And if we happen to come upon somebody we like, and then listener artist is if you submit something, mm-hmm. and we post it, you're the listener artist of the week.
Yes.
Because sometimes we post artists that don't necessarily listen and they're just regular. Mm-hmm. But hopefully now he is a listener after talking to him this week.
Hopefully. I'll tell him to check out the show.
The Maya stuff that he does, mm-hmm. man, it looks great. I mean,
looks
we're talking
really
like,
clean.
It's Pixar level. It's very, very, very nice looking.
Yes.
So it's going to be great to talk about, because I really want to talk about that workflow and Maya, because,
yeah,
you know, I'm not a big Maya guy. I'd love to know more about it.
I know.
So, and then we also have a listener artist of the week, which is Ivan Fusi. Gosh, I hate trying to pronounce names.
If you send us your stuff, please tell us how to pronounce your name.
it's Ivan. Okay, now.
Oh, Raleigh, the artist of the week, or mm-hmm. you know, he sent us a thing. It was because he took the Nintendo model that we had made,
right?
And so he did like a little animation in Cinema 4D, and he wanted to kind of show it off. He sent it to us, and hey, I built this using your model. So that was cool. That was cool.
It's because he's just starting in cinema and is a Maya guy.
Yeah. So,
but I'm sure he's going to have no problem after doing Maya. Jeez.
So, Ivan Fusi, I believe.
And Ivan is actually on the Octane Render group.
Oh, okay.
And so, I'm just posting a link to to that on the site, too. Yeah, some great looking stuff.
Oh, my gosh. There. His page is insane. That is so good.
Yeah, there's some great stuff there.
Gosh,
so another
people
Octane
like
guy.
This just make me so jealous.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So, I found a cassette tape today. I cleaned out the old garage this weekend. Found a cassette tape, and I'm going to have
What's a cassette tape?
Yeah. I'm going to have to clip this deal that I found, because I found all these cassettes, and talk about memory lane. I mean, stuff with me and my brother mm-hmm. doing goofy radio shows, mm-hmm. and I found the answering machine tape from my parents' answering machine.
Okay.
Like, both sides, A and B, full of messages from the 80s, which was awesome to listen to. It's really funny.
All right.
Even found one where my dad was calling in like late night, mm-hmm. like telling my mom, sorry, I'm not home yet. Like, mm-hmm. he was out with the guys or out with somebody.
That's
and
funny.
You could tell he was probably in trouble. Like,
that's
so
funny.
I found this one tape and it looked really old. It looked like a 70s tape, but I must have like taped over something because I used it in like, I guess it was the early 90s or whatever, but I was interviewing a friend of my dad's about computers and I just happened to fast forward through it and hit play right at the moment when he started talking about VR. And he's talking about, this is probably, if I had to guess, I would say this is 1991.
Okay.
And he's talking about VR and how within the next 12 to 18 months, we're going to see VR become a really big thing. And he's talking about headsets. He's talking about hand, you know, like gloves and stuff for, that you can use for VR and the whole deal. And it's just, it was so interesting to listen to him talk about that.
Yeah.
And I think I was interviewing him for a school project where I had to write about computers. And so,
that's so funny.
I was just recording on this cassette tape.
Who knew it, it would take 30 more years?
I know, and it's still not down, right?
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah, Dave's going to insert that interview right here.
No. Wrong.
Oh, boy. I thought my computer just froze for a second. I was about to freak out.
That would suck.
Haven't had a crash yet.
Knock on wood.
I switched over my you know, like Octane. I thought Octane was crashing my machine and stuff like that, and so I basically unplugged my computer from a power supply and moved it over to its own plug. And it's been good for me so far.
That's good. Hopefully that was the problem. I hope so. Speaking of which, I'll bring this up now because I'm thinking about it. Sarah sent us something. She was our listener artist last week. She sent something back to me. Actually, she sent something to us earlier in the week. She had her first like Cinema 4D animation on The Nightly Show.
Yeah.
And we watched
You should post that.
And yeah, I'll try and find the Hulu link because I watched it on Hulu.
Okay.
A little sign that's in the water and whatnot. So that was cool because it's like, hey, we know her.
Yeah.
And then I sent her something back and she said, because she's been just starting to learn about Octane and start to use it.
Yes.
And just got it. She said, tonight, sent me an email, said, update on my Octane situation that seems relevant to something you guys mentioned last episode. I'm now up and running with Octane using a single 980 Ti. I'm assuming on a Mac. She didn't say.
I don't know.
I'm assuming that means on the Mac, like the Octane Monster type situation. And it requires no external power supply. Just thought I'd mention.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. And like we said, I think it takes considerably less wattage than previous cards. You'd probably be pushing it with two of them. You might be pushing it with one. I'd be willing to bet that every now and then you may be doing something while rendering and the thing just like has a little freak out sesh.
Yeah. Don't run After Effects while you're running it.
I made a mistake like that this week.
Did you?
I was doing way too much. I was running a pretty hardcore render in Octane. What was I rendering? I think I had motion blur for one, so that makes it even worse. Because it's doing like all these calculations in between frames. I'm exporting. This is so stupid. I was exporting from After Effects at the same time.
Okay.
I was exporting David's tutorial as in the background, which I forgot about.
In Premiere.
And I also, at the same time, was making the animated GIF of the tutorial in Photoshop.
Oh, my gosh.
And my computer
just
shut off.
Oh, gosh.
It went, nope. Excuse me while I reset myself. Oh, man, and the fans power up and all that. I'm like, oh, that's probably pushing it just a bit too much.
Yeah.
My bad. Sorry. Trying to multitask.
Funny. Yeah, know, don't run whatever. After Effects and Cinema 4D at the same time.
Yeah.
But, oh, speaking of running both of them at the same time, so Cinema 4D Lite. So I used Cinema 4D Lite this week because you and I were working for a client who... has these After Effects. It's some just 2D After Effects stuff, And they wanted to incorporate some 3D movements and camera moves and stuff like that. And so I thought this would be really easy in cinema. I'll spend less time doing it in cinema versus After Effects. Mm-hmm. And so every time I would create a new Cinema 4D file, it would go to my regular Cinema 4D. And I didn't want it to do that. I wanted it to go to Light because I wanted the limitations that Light gives you. So if they ever needed to open it,
right,
they wouldn't have any problems.
Mm-hmm.
So trying to figure out how to get it to run Light, it's actually really easy once I finally, you know, figured it out. In your After Effects project, I believe if you click on the, if you drag your Cinema 4D, .c4D file into your timeline and then click on it and go to your Effects tab, in your options, I believe there's an options tab or something, it'll ask you what version you want to open up. Mm. And so you just need to redirect it to the Cinema 4D Lite version. And then yeah. once you edit it, I believe it's Command E or whatever, it'll bring up Cinema 4D Lite instead of your regular one, which is cool. Because then, like, you know, being so used to being in the Cinema 4D world, knowing Cinema 4D Lite is there, and being able to do these really simple things that they need quickly, you know, who cares if they need to edit it? I'm not worried about that. If they want to edit it, they can learn Cinema 4D.
But at least they can edit it.
Right.
You're not at locking them out.
At least they can edit yeah. it. Yeah. I'm not, you know, I'm allowing
them. Not a
them.
Monster.
Right. So.
It's a good thing to do for your client. Keep in mm-hmm. consideration their situation because yep. they're gonna like that. If it comes back and you're like, oh yeah, I did it with this program, you already own it, so you don't mm-hmm. have to worry about it, they're gonna like that and they'll yep. hire you again.
Yeah.
You know, it's good.
Or you could just use your own program and be like, oh, you need to do that, well, I used my program, so you're gonna have to bring me back to yeah. work. And they're gonna be like, oh, you got us this time.
It's like ransomware.
Right. That's funny.
So let's talk about home office.
Okay.
Home office, it, like you're working out of your home.
Yes.
Home office, work-life balance.
Gosh, I wish. So all last week I worked in another office, someone mm-hmm. else's office, and I'm doing yeah. that all this week.
Yeah.
And I hate it.
It makes you grateful, doesn't it?
Yeah, man. Uh-huh. Working from home is the bomb. Like, mm-hmm. and my house goes to absolute crap when I am not working from home, you know, because I'm so exhausted from a day at the office, you know, and my wife is so exhausted from her
drink.
Job. You know, we both get home really late and it's just like, we don't want to do anything. We don't want to clean. We don't want to cook, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't know how I did it working in a normal office. Dude, you get spoiled. You know, and she even said that she likes me working from home because, you know, I'll be doing my thing, blah, blah, blah. And then I'll go downstairs and, you know, make myself some lunch. And while I'm doing that, I clean up,
you right.
know, I'll clean the kitchen or I'll vacuum the floor or something like that. So, mm-hmm. you know, the house kind of stays clean while that's happening.
And you gain that time back too. You know,
absolutely.
If you have like, say you have an hour to work and an hour home,
mm-hmm.
you know, or just all that pack up time and get home and mm-hmm. you know, all that, you gain a lot of that time back. And
yeah,
that's either more time you can devote to doing housework or mm-hmm. working more or
yeah,
you know, whatever. But
I'm lucky that the office I've been working out of is really close to my house, you know, so it's yeah. not a huge drive. It's not a drive like my last job. You know,
but when you're at home, though, you and I, we both have offices that are kind of separate mm-hmm. areas of the house,
mm-hmm.
not even just separate rooms, but
yeah.
full on separate areas. Yours yeah. is upstairs.
Mine is. Yeah, I have an upstairs and it's one big room. You know, you mm-hmm. could use it for a playroom. You could use it for a theater room or whatever. I just use it for the office.
And I'm kind of the same situation. Mm-hmm. Like I have, my house is weird.
Yeah, it is.
it's a tri-story house. It's a tri-level house,
mm-hmm.
which it's still two stories. It just has weird levels and,
yeah.
and it's split also.
Mm-hmm.
So like one side of my house is the bedroom and all the other bedrooms and stuff. And the other side of the upstairs third story of my house is mm-hmm. all the office stuff. So it mm-hmm. is incredibly separated yeah. from the rest of the house. And I see people who work out of their house, but their office is also their bedroom. And I'm like, ugh. Dude, how?
Yeah.
Can you imagine? Like, yeah. I mean, I know maybe some, for some people, it's probably fine, but I mean, talk about no separation.
Yeah. That's tough.
That seems tough to me.
Yeah.
When you're working from home, you have to be able to just like, and I know this will never happen, but well, you have to be able to cut it off somehow.
Here's the good thing about working from home that I've noticed is that having our offices so different than our regular house, you know, like I don't come upstairs to my office to like pay bills or send an email or, you know, I've got workout equipment up, but I don't work out up here. And, but I don't normally come upstairs unless I'm putting the cat to bed, you know, and or working. And so it's really nice because downstairs is that's my separation. It's like, as soon as I cross the threshold of my stairs, I'm in home mode.
That's your commute.
Yeah. That's my commute. It's 24 stairs or whatever.
Yeah.
So
I feel like if maybe somebody's listening and they're in their home office, that's in their bedroom. Now, of course, you may not have the space. You might not have the money to be able to do something like that. Totally understandable.
There's some people who are, and I mean, I worked, my office was in my bedroom way back in the day when I could only afford an apartment, you know, that's what you got to do.
Yeah. But in that position, I'm sure it was probably tough because you just knew you never leave that room.
Yeah.
And you got to have that change of scene. Now, if you're in the position where you might have the option and you're thinking about it, like it's totally worth it if you're on the edge and you're thinking about a way to keep that separation because, man, you can just get burnt out. You know, especially like if you're like me, where if it weren't for taking my daughter to school and going to work out in some of the afternoons, I would never leave.
No, you wouldn't.
I would never change my clothes.
You don't anyway.
I don't change my clothes anyway. Yeah, I
gray shirt like, and pajamas.
Man, always.
Always.
I'm always in my pajamas. You know, it's great, but the thing is, like, you can get burnt out on that, and not even if you're working a lot, just like being like, you'll get cabin fever. You know, just kind of feel like you're like you have to get out and do stuff, and you're going to burn out, so you have to do other things. And even if it's not like a work-life balance thing, even if it's like, for example, you and I were talking about a slow start to May, business-wise, for us.
Yes.
Then in the late May, we got like a crazy amount of stuff, and we're probably going to have record sales for May, which is incredible to think that that happened in like 2 weeks. But in doing so, we totally like have been working round the clock.
Yes. It's tough.
Like to the point
we were kind of able to take off this weekend for the most part.
For the most part.
It wasn't until like two or three today that we kind of, you know, re-collaborated.
Which was much needed because, see, I was already taking off Friday, which I barely did. I ended up taking
sorry about
off
that.
Like... No, it's not just that. It was like other stuff too, and I ended up maybe having 3 hours to myself. But the day before that, I had just wrapped up so much stuff, you and I both, and that I was trying to sit here. I was trying to concentrate. I was like, I had stuff on my list I knew I needed to get to, but my brain was just not physically allowing me to concentrate anymore.
Yeah.
It's like it knew subconsciously that I had hit the wall and that I didn't have to have that stuff done on Thursday. And it just was like, no, I'm not going to let you concentrate.
Yeah.
No matter how much spark you drink, no matter how many espresso shots you have, like I'm not going to allow you to do this. So this happens to me all the time. And I tell my brain is telling me to stop, and I just keep trying to go. And I just have to be able to stop and tell myself, okay, stop and go do something else. Don't think about it anymore. So that's what I did Friday.
Yeah.
I said, okay, I'm going to play video games for 3 hours and completely veg out.
Good. What'd you play?
Halo.
Oh, okay.
bet.
How is it? I need to get an Xbox.
It's awesome. Oh, man. It's so
that we can play.
New Halo is so addictive and so great. So great.
Man, I just don't have time for video games. I wish I did.
Neither do I.
Yeah.
But that's why, you know what? That makes it more fun when you do get to play it, though.
That's true. Yeah.
And, I mean, I used to play all the time.
Yeah, but one time I can't anymore. You know, I'd heard great things about Skyrim, so I bought Skyrim, and I was like, okay, I've got a couple hours to burn, you know? So I started playing Skyrim, and then I got through making my character, and then I was done.
Yeah. Oh, that happens. But Halo's a little different, because they're short 10-minute games.
Mm-hmm.
You can just jump right in.
Pwn some noobs.
Yeah, you can pwn some noobs.
Or get pwned.
Get pwned. They call me My Little Pony.
Mm.
So you got to do something else. Whatever it is, like play video games, go outside, exercise, ride a bike, do whatever. Or if you prefer to stay inside, get on Reddit, you know, whatever. Get your fill of dank memes. You know, and, you know, whatever it is you do to relax, like, you know, smoke one of your jazz cigarettes. You know what I'm saying?
I guess.
I mean, let's be honest. We're talking to a bunch of creative people here, right? You know, there's probably quite a few listeners enjoying the sweet, sweet Sheba.
I don't know. I know we've got a few people who in Colorado listeners.
Yeah, there you go. See? Jazz cigarette. Love that term. It's my new favorite term.
All right.
Jazz cigarette. Forget where I heard that.
I don't know. I heard you say it the other day.
Yeah, it's great. And yeah, be present in your life, you know, and do your family stuff. Like I'm bad at it, but I'm trying all the time to be present in the moment, with my family, be there. Like I'm in front of them. I'm there right now. Be in that moment. And devote that family time. There's one thing about Gary Vee that I don't know if I don't agree with it or don't understand how he does it or whatever, but when does he spend time with his family?
I don't know.
Because he's married, he's got a kid.
Yeah, I think he's got two kids now.
Or two kids. When does he spend time? I mean, he's working around the clock, and I don't know. Like, I never hear him talk about stopping. He's always talking about take every spare moment you possibly have and be working all the time, always.
Yeah.
So to me, I just kind of wonder about his family life.
Yeah, I don't know.
Because, I don't know, I feel like, I mean, I'm definitely still working on that, trying to be present. And I don't, I feel like my impression, you know, I don't follow everything that Gary Vee does, so maybe I've missed this.
Yeah.
But my impression, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I mean, I don't know. All I know is I try and spend as much time with my family as possible.
Right.
You know, it's such a hard thing to do is create that work-life balance, even working from home, you know. But I try to make sure that I, you know, help in the stressful areas that can be, like getting the kid to bed, you know, or at least getting him ready for bed. That kid doesn't go to sleep until like midnight.
That's something a little bit different with y'all.
Like, yeah.
Your wife goes to your bed like super late, and so does your son.
Yeah.
And
trust me, it's not the kid thing is not by choice.
Well, he's understandable.
I try and get him in bed by 8:30, but man, he is a ball of energy right now, and just does not chill. He doesn't know the meaning of chill. You know, he is up at 7:30 in the morning asking for a Graggle bar, which is a granola bar, you know, and he is nonstop going until we can finally just stick him in the car and we drive around for a few minutes and he passes out for 2 hours. Then he's back up and wants another Graggle bar and he's good to go.
See, my wife and daughter go to bed, like my daughter goes to bed at 7 p.m. or 7:30. And it's going to be a little later in the summer. School's about to be out or whatnot. But dude, she needs that, though.
My kid during the summer is not going to go to bed like until every night is going to be midnight. I know it. And that's what's going to be so hard because my wife's a teacher. So she's got the summer off. He won't have to go to daycare. And I work from home.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like all of us are going to be home at the same time.
Oh, dude.
And, you know, like, when during the summer, I call my wife Summer Amy. You know, she's always like super happy and like stays up till 3 a.m.
Yeah.
Watching TV, which is totally fine, you know, but I know I'm going to get stuck in this routine too, which is staying up till 3 a.m.
Right.
And then, but it'll be nice because I won't have to take him to daycare, you know, so I can get up basically at 9 o'clock and just start working.
See, Christy goes to bed at like freaking 8:30 because she works out at 5 a.m, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
She gets up at 4:20. Every morning. And so, like, for me, the balance, I guess, is a little easier because, really, it's from the time they get home from 5 until 8. That's the only time I have anyway. So it's just like, okay, stop what you're doing right between these 3 hours.
Yeah, see, that's kind of what I do, too. You know, like, I'll stop working around 4 when I'm working from home. I don't normally go pick up my kid from daycare. He's only 2 minutes away. But then I'll bring him upstairs and like let him hang out with me if I need to finish up any work up until my wife gets home. And then I'll try and spend as much time as I can with them until like it's basically work is over, you know, up until maybe 9 o'clock. But I always feel bad because, you know, she's still awake. She's watching TV and nights I have to work. So that's hard. It's hard being able to say, okay, I got to not work tonight. You know,
right.
I've got to try and work really hard so that I don't have to work tonight.
And then there's also those nights that you have, that you say, I have to work tonight.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, and that happened to me last week. Christy like actually had some nights available, like just hang out, watch new Kimmy Schmidt or whatever.
Have you caught up?
No, I'm not done with it yet. No spoilers.
Oh, man, it's so good.
It is good.
Yeah.
But it's one of those things where like, we were going so around the clock that and stuff was due. It's like, I have to work tonight.
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, I'll just like work for 30 minutes and then come to bed and then I'll finish it tomorrow. Like, no, this has to be done.
Yeah.
That's a little frustrating.
Yeah, it is.
But, you know, you own your own business. You just, you have to make those sacrifices sometimes to keep things going. There's nothing you can do. Really, except say, okay, on the nights that I don't have to have something done, I'll try and make some time then.
Yep.
You know, for
family's more important than work. Yeah,
true.
That's true. True.
But see, that's the conflict that goes on in your mind, right? Mm-hmm. If you own your own business, family's more important than work, but you got to take care of your family, which is your number one priority. In order to do that, you have to work.
I know, it's catch-22.
It's your catch-22, is what do you do? Now, there's some people out there that are single, which I know that there's a lot of like young, single artists, Cinema 4D, motion graphics people who are like, I don't have this problem.
Yeah, I'm going to fast forward.
Yeah, well, lucky you that you have the time to do what you have to do right now.
Yeah. Learn as much as you can and crush it as hard as you can right now.
Before.
Because you listen to the old folks. The old folks are giving you giving you advice.
When I was your age, the thing is, like, you will not regret getting married and having a family. That's not what we're saying.
Nope, not at all.
But like, take advantage of that time, because I swear to you, I think now I'm like, what did I do when I was 25 years old? Every night,
a lot of drinking. Yeah,
I guess that's all I can think of. I wasn't doing anything else.
Yep, a lot of drinking.
I should have been learning Octane 1.0. I don't know.
That's funny.
Yeah, hindsight, man.
It's all right.
Yeah. Now here's something super meta when it comes to this. What about your work balance? You own your own business.
Yeah.
You've got a lot of different areas. You've got sales.
Yes.
You got accounting, invoicing, taxes. Yeah. You've got...
That sounds like a really good setup for Wave Apps.
Right? And now into our sponsor... No. They don't take sponsors.
They don't sponsor us.
Yeah, they don't sponsor people. But keeping your office work separate from your other work, basically. Let's just call it office work Cinema 4D
here's
work,
something
I guess,
that is really
graphics work.
Here's something that's really interesting. Like... Okay, so we run a tutorial website, right?
Right.
And we run the podcast. Mm-hmm. So really, BroGraph is one job. And then our company, where we're actually, you know, because we don't make money on BroGraph.
No.
We have spent
Not yet,
way anyway. More money on BroGraph right. than we have made. So, not
the
yet.
Point is, maybe someday it will make money.
Someday we will. But really, actually, I think BroGraph is mostly... you said something the other day when I was talking about, you know, David doing a tutorial for us, and I was like, well, what if we make a bunch of money off of this tutorial? How do we split it all up? And you said something along the lines of, oh, it'll be great for the for your exposure or
right,
something like that,
right.
you know?
It'll be
and
great exposure.
And that's what I realized, is that BroGraph for us is only for the exposure. You
of
know?
Course.
We don't do it to make money.
That's what...
Sure,
that's
on YouTube,
what
we throw
does.
Ads at the beginning of YouTube, but we don't make barely anything on
well,
those
it,
ads.
It's the same concept that everybody in this type of economy is going with right now, is like, build the audience first,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Build a brand,
mm-hmm.
get an audience,
mm-hmm.
and then at some point, you'll figure out how to make money.
Right.
You know, it's the question mark profit.
Right.
Right.
But see, what I've noticed is... So anyway, we've got two separate entities, you know,
mm-hmm.
BroGraph, and that's actually really hard balancing the work making money and mm-hmm. the BroGraph exposure, trying to, you know, do the social networking thing and get our yeah. name out there, you know, because one day we want to be speaking at some of these presentations and stuff like that. We want
right.
to be the face of Octane for Cinema 4D, you know, and we want to do all this stuff, and we'd love for it to eventually make money, you know, but we're really doing this for the exposure so much more than, you know,
well
doing,
and to help people I
and
mean,
to help
let's
people
not
for
rule
sure
that
yeah.
out
no,
I mean
no no
that,
I mean
love doing that
yeah for sure yeah we love yeah. talking shop with people, you know, getting the emails man, those are the best.
Yeah.
So, but like,
but that's the startup mentality now, though, is
yeah.
that you're just going to go do something
mm-hmm.
and then eventually you're going to maybe sell a product or
yeah,
something.
Figure out how to monetize it.
Yeah.
Which, you know, and that's what we started out doing, was just throwing the ads on YouTube, you know?
Right.
And we still do that with the tutorials and stuff. But if you go to Vimeo, you don't have to see the ads.
Yeah, that's true.
So, and I think our website, if you go to our website, do we post the YouTube or the Vimeo?
It's the YouTube.
Okay, never mind. Yeah. You'll have to see ads on our site. Go to Vimeo.
I don't know if the ads, well, I don't know. I don't know how that works. I don't know.
So, anyway, but balancing that work, you know, is kind of hard because, you know, you'll be at work either at someone's office or at home and you're working on something, but then you get a tweet and you want to be able to respond to them really quickly
right.
and say, what up, you know, blah, 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 or answer questions or even open up a project of theirs and see if you can help them out. You know,
mm-hmm.
that's a really tough thing to balance.
And it's
also I don't think I figured it out yet.
No, me neither, because I'll be sitting there like, oh man, I need to email these people back and I need to do this mm-hmm. invoice, and then I'm jumping all around mm-hmm. and I'm not getting to the actual work.
Yeah.
You know, like, or the other day I'm trying to work on the plugin and I never even opened it up, because by the time I was done jumping between like literally 15 different things,
yeah,
there was no time left of the day.
Yeah, totally.
And that's a hard thing in itself right there. You got to be able to say, okay, I'm going to go in the morning. I'm going to answer my 20 emails that I got last night.
Mm-hmm.
Good
You get
Lord.
Way more emails than I do.
It's not really 20 overnight, but it is ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where, like, last Monday I was sitting there on Skype
mm-hmm.
and I'm talking to David and I'm trying to get to something that we're going to work on, but I'm like, I have to finish these emails first. And every time I send an email, I swear to you, three more came in.
That's funny.
I was like, oh my God. And every single one of them had something I had to that was an issue I had to address.
That could be a good problem.
Know? Or, I mean, it could be a good problem, but, you know, if you want to get into more of that, I mean, that's Merlin Man type stuff right there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, about the email stuff. But there is a time when you need to sit down and address those issues. So that's what I was doing. But man, you really have to separate that and be able to say, okay, I'm closing the email. And then that is one of the reasons, like I tell you, I don't like to have that ding on that tells me I have an email.
Yeah, because see, no, I can't not.
It frustrates. You know? I mean, if you're sitting there trying to answer these emails
yeah,
and not
see,
getting
like,
to work.
Maybe that's the problem. You let your emails pile up. So then you have to dedicate a lot of your time in order to the emails. Like to me, it's I get a ding I open it up, or I have my email open at all times, and I see the little number pop up to see how many I have, I'll move over to it, answer the email real quick, and I'm back at what I'm working on.
But that's what I'm saying. It takes more cycles to stop what you're doing, to address something, and then get back on track with what you're doing. Like, it distracts you. When you're working in cinema, you kind of get in a flow, and if you're stopping that every 5 minutes, because that's what happens. My emails just don't stop.
Well, Mr. Popular.
You know, it's one of those things where, for me, like, if I have the ding, mm-hmm. ding, 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 it's just like someone jabbing at me. It's just like, let me concentrate on what I'm doing. Once I get done, if something is an emergency, mm-hmm. you're going to get a phone call, right? Yeah. I mean, hopefully people are smart enough to know that, right?
Hopefully.
I would hope that, I would think that way.
Yeah.
If something was like crashing and burning really bad, and I wouldn't email somebody and expect them. I mean, are you gonna email 911?
If I could.
You know, and hope that it shows up on the other end. No, I want to get on the phone. I expect somebody to answer like right away. Mm-hmm. Be like, yes, what do you want? What do you want? Like right then. Mm-hmm. I'm not gonna email them because I don't know if it's been received on the other end, let alone if somebody's addressing the situation. So,
yeah, I don't know. Oh, maybe they do make single slot Titan X's.
Squirrel.
Oh, by the way, mm-hmm. so I just opened up iTunes to check to see if we had any more reviews this week.
Mm-hmm.
And I clicked on iTunes is so stupid. It really is the worst. So I clicked on reviews, and we didn't have any new reviews, and I clicked on related. You know,
mm-hmm.
and you know what it brings up?
What?
Comic book podcasts, because we are visual arts.
Well, maybe we should change our category.
I think we should.
I don't know what else to do, because I went through and I double checked all of our tags, all of our iTunes information, all of that stuff.
I don't know.
It says Cinema 4D all over everything, but if you type in Cinema 4D in iTunes, we don't come up.
Yeah.
So maybe I'll change the category, because I don't know what else. I picked it because other people were in
maybe
the category.
Maybe do software how-to. That's what Creative Cow does.
It's not, I don't know. There's, you know, if you look up Cinema 4D, mm-hmm. all the other ones are in different categories. Like, I think
Grayscales is in design.
Yeah, see, it's in design. See, we are more design,
software,
I guess.
Software how-to.
What are we under again?
Visual arts.
Visual arts. It just, I don't know.
Jeez. Just the way, and yeah. I don't know, it's stupid.
iTunes sucks.
It really does. Apple kind of sucks.
But you type Cinema 4D, and like every episode has a tag of Cinema 4D in the description, in the summary, and everything, and you get nothing. Mm-hmm. Nothing at all. You click on see all results for Cinema 4D, and we're not in, there's like 20 people in there, and nothing for
but,
us.
But, you
I
know,
don't understand that.
David uses Overcast. Mm-hmm. And so I downloaded Overcast. You type in Cinema 4D, boom, we're the top one.
That's what I'm saying.
Grayscale's just underneath us, you know?
It doesn't make sense.
It doesn't. It's really dumb.
Because that one's at least using the tags correctly and is mm-hmm. doing the search correctly. And I just, for the love of God, I mean.
I know. Weren't they.
iTunes, Apple, do something.
Didn't Apple just put out something where they were talking to someone about podcasts?
Yeah, that's, I think I was talking about that last week or the week before. But yeah, totally.
They need to do something better with it. Apple, I don't know. I hate that I'm so stuck in their little world, you mm-hmm. know? And like, it's just like, I don't know. Am I just angry because they've gotten so big, you know? Did I like them before they were cool or whatever?
I don't think that's the case.
I don't know. Like, I feel like Apple used to be, they used to care about the artist, you know?
And now it's just they definitely don't anymore.
Now they just want, like, anyone to be an artist, I guess, you know? And give you the tools to be a good artists but not have any talent. I don't know. It's annoying.
There's a lot of things that I look at it and say, Steve Jobs would have never approved of this.
Right.
A lot of people say that.
You know, and the Apple TV layout, the mm-hmm. user interface, or the UI or whatever, mm-hmm. is a perfect example, because they actually brought that to him before he died, and he said, no way. And then right. as soon as he died, that's what they released.
And do you have a new Apple TV?
No.
The new Apple TV is even worse.
Is it?
Now, I love the new Apple TV. I mm-hmm. wish that all my Apple TVs were the new one. Like, I love everything about it.
You know what? If you got a Chromecast, you would never go back. I'll tell you that right now. It. You get a Chromecast, you will never go back. They're $35. Well, I have one on every single TV I own.
Well, I like this because, I mean, it has the games, it has Siri, it has,
yeah.
you know, I mean, like, there's some really cool things about it. But here's what bugs me. If you go to Hulu, let's say,
uh-huh.
and you click on recent episodes
mm-hmm.
of something,
mm-hmm.
and you want to see the episodes, you have to scroll all the way to the right
mm-hmm.
to see the episode you didn't watch.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the new episode, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you're done with the show and that after screen comes up, like mm-hmm. if you back out of it, it will say like the following episodes, and they're arranged the opposite way from left to right of newest to oldest.
And you know,
it's like Steve Jobs would have never approved of that.
No, he was way big about like the way a user interacts with their items,
the intuitiveness of
yes,
everything.
Absolutely. And I feel like that is completely gone now.
Yeah.
Like it is totally gone.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll tell you the number one thing that I hate about Apple TV. When I stream something to it, say I go to Netflix and I click on an episode and then I AirPlay it to my Apple TV,
mm-hmm.
it kills my phone battery. You know, and then I leave the app and it stops everything on my TV. That is ridiculous. It should not do that. You know,
see, I don't ever stream Netflix to the TV because there's Netflix on the TV.
I know, but still, you should be able to. It should just be.
It should hand off.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and that's what Google, the Chromecast does.
Yeah, it does.
You know, and you just say, stream this, and it says, okay, here it is. You know?
And that's with anything. Like, if you have a YouTube link and mm-hmm. you play it, it goes to the Chromecast and it says, okay, here's this YouTube link. And then it goes to the internet, mm-hmm. it takes that YouTube link and it starts mm-hmm. playing that.
Absolutely.
And it's just going. It's not going through your Wi-Fi from your phone back to the Wi-Fi.
Right. I mean, why does it even need my phone? It shouldn't need my phone on the Apple mm-hmm. TV. And it just kills my battery.
Totally.
You know? Anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it makes sense when you're streaming other stuff to it.
Yeah.
But come on.
I know. It's stupid.
I mean, come on. Yeah.
Apple. I have a feeling it may be getting close to PC time. It's okay. Man. I mean, you could do a Hackintosh.
No.
You know?
No, God, no.
Yeah, I mean, they're...
I've looked into it. No, I really have. I've talked to some people, and mm-hmm. they're like, dude, this is a pain in the butt.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I really like...
You just got to build a PC to do your work on, and then use your Mac for all your other stuff, unfortunately.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, I would keep my setup like this, and I would just build a PC and put it on a B-side of a KMV switch or something.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what else to do. But I wouldn't want to work on it. I mean, just like I talked about last week, trying to get the stupid Oculus Rift to work took me 6 freaking hours. I don't want to do that with everything I install.
Yeah.
And it will happen. And I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
I mean, I started on Windows way back in the day. I was a Windows person. I was anti-Mac back in like mm-hmm. the late 90s.
Windows 94.
94?
Yeah. What was before that?
That's not a thing.
Windows 94? No, heck yeah, it was.
That's not a thing.
You sure about that?
I'm positive it's not a thing. Windows 3.11 to 95.
Oh. Windows 95. Maybe that's what I meant.
Yeah. I listened to some of the startup sounds from Windows on YouTube the other day. Man, nostalgia.
Yeah.
And the nostalgia for the different versions of Windows startup.
Hey, do you remember... Hey, remember this?
Hey, who remembers Windows? Am I right?
Who remembers Windows 95?
Hey, you guys remember computers?
Hey, you remember Norton Desktop?
Yeah. That crazy fool.
Do you remember... what's the toaster one? Flying Toasters or whatever?
Oh, yeah, yeah. What was it called? After Dark.
Was that?
After Dark. Screensaver. That's right. Flying Toasters, man. That was a big deal. And was it Windows 95 that had the Weezer video embedded in the,
yeah, totally,
in the CD? And that other one with the woman who's like, good times, bad times, give me some of that. I don't remember what her name was.
I don't remember that.
That was the other video with the Weezer video, I believe.
I don't remember that at all.
Yeah. So let's talk about the dystopian fad. You brought this up this week, and you were like, let's not talk about it. And then you're like, let's
talk about
it.
Thank you for
bringing it up. No, but then you said, okay, we can talk about it.
I don't know. I just, you know, a lot of the, there's a big dystopian fad going on right now. You know, and I'm just not, it's, what's that movie? Kung Fury or whatever?
Yeah, but that's not dystopian. That's like 80s.
Yeah, I know. Well, this dystopian 80s look, you know,
it's people, a little different.
People does a lot of it. Ash Thorpe does a lot of it, you know. Yep. And I've seen a lot of people. Is it because people is doing this that everyone else is doing this?
Well, I think so, and that's the thing. It's not to rag on people.
Yeah,
it's not to rag on Ash Thorpe. Is more of an interface guy. He doesn't like interfaces.
I don't know.
It's a little less than the Beeple stuff, like spaceman walking through dystopian landscape,
right?
That he posts every day,
right?
But that's his style because he invented it, right?
Yeah.
Like EJ has his style that he has invented, right?
Yeah.
And even talking about the project we're working on for Zika, we're like, oh, we'll do the EJ style.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's EJ style. That's him. He came up with that, so he can do that. Beeple can do spacemen walking through dystopian landscape every day.
Yeah,
because he invented that.
Yeah,
for the, like, not
Grayscale can do shiny balls.
Right,
he does shiny balls.
He invented the shiny balls.
Yeah.
So, like, I don't know. It's those people's style.
Yeah, I know. But, like, you know, I don't know. I just feel like there's so much of it going on. It's like that is the. That is the new low poly, you know?
Yeah, or even Already Been Chewed.
Yeah.
Already Been Chewed as a style. I mean, now, part of that's because he's a skater.
Mm-hmm.
He's a skater boy. He said, see you later, boy. And he went and did Cinema 4D stuff after doing skating. And now he does... And now he does like a lot of skate related stuff. He does a lot of shoes, like awesome looking shoes, by the way.
Oh,
like,
I have two links. Those shoes look so good.
I have two links, by the way. Mm-hmm. One shoe thing that he just got done with, and that'll be in the show notes. And then another one he posted this week of like a stage thing he did for somebody's presentation that was super cool looking. But that's his style.
Yeah.
Right? That's his thing. Even Mike the Monkey had certain things that were like his style, and like he worked with Mark Echo, I think, on some stuff. But that's the style, and then people try and copy that, and I'm just like, why are you trying to copy that?
Yeah.
Now, if you're an artist and you're working for somebody, I understand copying a style. Like, if the client comes to you and they have a valid reason for using this particular style. Like, if someone came to us and they said, we want to do this shoe, and it has to have this real skater look to it and stuff, I'm going to be like, okay, well, obviously, we know what style we have to do.
Right.
But I'm not going to sit there every day and try and
copy... Right, we'd go with the EJ Hasenfrost.
Right. But I'm not going to sit there and try and copy Barton Damer every day just for fun because I like his style and I'm just going to do his style all the time every day. That's going to be my style. I want my own style.
Yeah.
And I feel like I kind of do have my own style if when I do my own stuff, and it's a combination of everything I've learned. Same thing with you.
I hope I don't have a crappy style.
Well, I certainly hope the same
people don't
thing.
Look at that and say, oh, that's a Milstead.
Right. Well, I mean, that could be in a good way. you know, we were talking about that with EJ the other day too. Mm-hmm. That it should be a compliment that people come up now and are starting to say, we mm-hmm. need to do the EJ style on this. Because, like, he has pioneered a style. Like, that's something to be proud of.
Yeah. I don't know. There's just Spaceman walking through dystopian landscape. There's so much dystopian stuff, and it's like, come on. What's the new fad going to be? I want to know what the new fad is going to be.
Well, we've talked about that on the show a lot.
I'm over this fad. I'm ready for the new one.
Yeah. Well, I do think that EJ's stuff is going to really blow up as a fad.
I really hope so.
Big time.
But he did that 80s one, you know? Yeah. It's like dystopian, you know, 80s Tron feely look.
Yeah, but that was the whole purpose of that was to show how to build that in cinema.
I guess.
To me, though, it's mainly the people who are doing it every day for fun over and over and over again. Copy, 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 copy.
Don't get me wrong. All their stuff is good.
It's good, but why is it so emulated? Like, it's great for practice.
Mm-hmm.
It's great for practice, of course. And you want to be able to copy styles.
Mm-hmm.
For that reason, if a client says, I want Picasso style, okay, sure. Somebody wants 2D cartoon style, okay, I can do that because I've practiced that.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're doing dystopian landscapes every day, you're going to, every, it's the, what's the phrase?
I don't know.
If every problem,
I have no idea what you're talking
about. If the only tool you have is a hammer, then every problem looks like a nail. Is that what it is?
Yeah, that makes sense.
If all you can do is dystopian landscapes, then your client's going to come to you and your solution is always going to be, well, we should do a dystopian landscape for this.
Yeah, like from the Brady Bunch movie when the dad Brady tried to show his house as every model for every architecture thing that he did.
Yeah.
Really awful reference.
I haven't seen that movie, but it's
you know the Brady Bunch movie that they redid?
Right. No, I haven't seen that.
Now I'll never be a teen model.
Yeah, Marsha, Marsha, Marsha.
Yeah.
I remember the preview with the football to the nose.
Right.
I remember that part. That's all I remember.
Football to the groin.
It's like, well, we have a new concept for a children's TV show. It needs to be really bright and colorful. I got it. We're going to have an astronaut going through a dystopian landscape because that's all I've ever done in my life.
Yeah.
You know, branch out, look for other styles, try and emulate everything and not just one thing. Like, people are just so big on just like sticking to whatever the fad is at the moment.
Yeah.
And to me, it pushes me away. It makes me not want to do that even more.
Yeah, I agree. That's what I was playing. I was making a dystopian landscape whenever my cinema crashed earlier.
Oh, were you?
Yeah. Well, it was. I wanted to try something out because, you know, there's the super 80s look of the... It's like really colorful, you know? Like hot pinks are big right now and purples and like really bright neon colors. So what I did was I went to Photoshop, did like a 3000 by 1500, 600 DPI, and then just took one of those super colorful gradients, you know, and created a gradient and made it a repeating pattern. Threw that into an HDRI and started building my stuff. So everything had this kind of look to it.
Interesting.
Yeah. I don't know.
Is that the one you were trying to do the motion blur on?
Yeah.
Yeah. Before it all crashed and burned.
Before it all took a dump.
I don't know if we've ever brought this up on the show, but if you're doing like in-camera motion blur for Octane, there's kind of a weird process in like testing it out. I don't know if anyone has a better solution, but
I have never actually done in-camera motion blur in Octane and haven't. I was just starting to play around with it when it crashed on me, you know?
It looks so good, though.
Yeah.
It looks so realistic. And there's things you can achieve with it that you can't do. Like, I did a drone flying last year, and there's no way you could do that. Even if you had a motion vector pass in RSMB Pro Vectors, there's no way you could ever get that look to the propellers. Because when the propellers spin, like the middle of the propellers kind of stay visible, but the outside is almost completely invisible.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no other way to do it. And so you have to, well, first of all, you got to turn on the vertex motion blur on your object tag to even make
so
it
pick up.
So you
need to actually put an object tag on there as well?
Well, you don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is that if you want it to interpret it differently, you have to put it on there.
Okay.
Like, it'll do everything by default. It will do motion blur.
I didn't see any motion blur.
Well, that's part of the thing. Okay, you got to turn on motion blur on your camera that you're using. And then after you turn it on, you have to set your... You have to set it pretty low, actually. Because, mm-hmm. And then there's also the thing of, you know, where is the motion blur? Is it like before the shutter, after the shutter? There's all that in there, mm-hmm. which I don't mess with that much, but I do mess with like the shutter speed, which the shutter speed isn't set to like a regular camera shutter speed. It's just kind of a float, mm-hmm. I guess. And so I think I always start with like 0.25 or 0.025, whatever it is. But when you're using your Octane viewer window, it doesn't show up right away. So you have to kind of...
Yeah, but I was scrubbing through.
Yeah.
And it wasn't showing anything still.
Yeah, but you have to like... You can't just like scrub... Like, you have to go to a frame and you have to update... You have to hit G and update one frame.
I did that.
Forward a frame.
I did
that.
And
then wait for it to calculate and do it again. And do it again.
I did that. Lots of times.
Hmm.
But then it crashed on me.
Well, actually, that might be a setting in your... Octane window settings to show the motion blur too.
Might not be that might have been it.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'd test it right now, but I can't get into my Cinema 4D.
Maybe it's back.
Maybe.
Maybe it's back. We'll
I'm
see.
I'm too scared to open it up while we're running a podcast.
But it's weird. Like, it doesn't update correctly in the window unless you give it a few frames to really fully update. So that's something that takes some finessing. And there's a lot of calculation time involved.
Yeah.
And then there's steps, like how many steps of motion blur.
Yeah.
There's a lot to it. And then sometimes you start your actual render and it looks like complete crap compared to how you tested it. So you just have to go back and, you know, let it actually render to the picture viewer a few frames and test it. But once you do, it's so pretty.
Yeah.
So pretty.
I believe it.
I've even been rendering like plain text stuff in Octane.
Really?
Just because it looks so good. Someone needs, and because it's so fast.
Yeah.
You know, someone needs like some plain white text with that nice diffused, you know, rough, you know, plain white text, but thick.
I mean, if you're going to do
great,
if you're going to do, you know, blurry reflections or, you know, displacement or something like that, heck yeah, use Octane.
It's just so, even just regular plain, you know, flat text. I've been doing that just because it's so fast to render.
Yep.
So got some links. Speaking of Octane, this one guy did a really good GTX 1080 benchmark versus the 980 SLI, the 980 Ti and Fury X.
What's the Fury X
difference? I think. See, this is again where I'm not big on the hardware. I think Fury X is like really hardcore.
Is it?
And so. I believe that's what it made it sound like. So I was like watching the video. It's a really long video.
I don't think it's hardcore.
Maybe he was joking. I don't know. I don't know what the Fury X is.
Sapphire Radeon R9, 4 GB.
Radeon. Radeon is a ATI thing, isn't it?
VR ready. AMD. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe that's anyway.
Okay.
I guess that makes sense because we're thinking in terms of Octane and where everything has to be NVIDIA. And I'm so in the NVIDIA world, I don't even think about any other brands anymore.
I know. It'll be nice once you can actually use AMD cards. I'm really interested to see how they fare, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, in comparison. The emulation or the, what do you call it, the reverse engineering they did.
Yeah.
So that's a good, it's a long video too.
Is it?
Good comparison. I saw another one. Here's the one thing there was some discussion on, and this is another thing we should bring up with Tom, is, you know, I went to the Otoy Octane Bench site where you can look at the benchmarks other people have run, their comparison mm-hmm. tests on cards and things like that. There's no 1080s in there. And so I forget, maybe it was you talking about the fact that the 1080s don't even work with Octane yet.
Yeah, I don't know. I want to say I heard that somewhere, but I don't know if that's true.
And I think I was reading maybe in the Skype thing, maybe it was even Tom saying that there's no, that it's possible they don't have Octane 3 working with the Pascal architecture yet.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's very possible that that's not even a possibility. I mean, there's no 1080 benchmarks on their site, so I'm guessing nobody's been able to run it yet.
Yeah, I don't know. So what's kind of amazing to me is that they announced the 1080 and it's now available for purchase so quickly.
Yeah, people have it already.
That's crazy to me.
It's crazy that a company could actually sell things when they announce them mm-hmm. instead of teasing you with them for a freaking year.
Yeah.
Like Apple does or whatever. Yeah. It's like, well, hey, how about that? It's actually shipping. The 1080, though, we were talking about last week, we hope for a 1080 Ti.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that the Founders version or whatever it's called is that version. I think there probably will be a Ti. There's rumors of it.
Yeah.
And if that's the case, that it's not working with Octane yet anyway, then might as well just hold out.
Yeah, totally.
No reason to really do anything else with it yet. I mean, unless you're playing games, I get that. But speaking of which, there's a Doom, because there's a new Doom game, mm-hmm. Doom on GTX 1080 performance mm-hmm. Equals insanity. This video, it'll be in the show notes. Oh my God.
It's so cool.
The thing is running 90 to 100 frames a second on average.
And it looks so clean.
And you put all the settings to
maximum, max.
It's crazy.
Over 9,000.
Definitely. And here's another Octane thing that came up this week
mm-hmm.
because we're working with a client who mm-hmm. has been waiting to upgrade or not upgrade, but to actually install Octane for the first time, been mm-hmm. waiting for Octane 3. And so we're looking at the packs.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at, they're looking at buying, they want three machines.
And your calculations, are they based on the new pricing?
It's based on
the
current pricing.
Okay. Have you looked at it tomorrow. On the new pricing?
I don't know.
No. Because that might be different.
Okay. Do you have a link to that? I thought the pricing didn't come out till tomorrow.
No, the pricing page doesn't come out till tomorrow. Oh, okay. Here they are. Final pricing on all V3 plugins. Damn it. Hold on. Okay, so pricing, because we were talking about this last week. V2, this is upgrade pricing, V3 license pricing. So standalone plus C4D is $619 for a combo license.
That's standalone.
Wait. Or six, and yeah.
Okay, when it previously was $459 US dollar.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I have that written here, so I know okay. that for a fact.
So $619 for a combo license.
So what you're saying is it's cheaper to buy version 2 today and upgrade it tomorrow.
Is that the case?
Well, I think so.
So how much is it now?
It would be $75 for the combo. Isn't mm-hmm. that what they said?
Yeah.
Siri, I'm not talking to you. Shut up. Good Lord. Yeah, I think that's to get $459 plus $75 would be less than whatever you said.
$534. That's like a $100 difference.
So buy now.
Yeah, if you're going to buy now before they release the new pricing.
Okay, but here's what came up, and here's what we couldn't figure out. And we checked online, we checked the mm-hmm. forums, we were looking at the pages. I was asking people.
Mm-hmm.
I was asking people. Nobody really could figure out what it was because this is three machines for three separate people. This isn't like they just want a render node or a floating. Like three separate people working in Cinema 4D and Octane. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
If you buy a standalone three pack
mm-hmm.
for the standalone render at $869, Mm-hmm. And then you buy a 3-pack of Cinema 4D plugin at $559.
Mm-hmm.
The total is $1,428.
Okay.
But if you buy the single combo pack, which is a standalone plus Cinema 4D plugin, mm-hmm. like one in one,
mm-hmm.
that's $459 a piece times three machines is $1,377. So it's cheaper not to buy the 3-pack. So therefore, yeah. my question and their question was, if you're buying Cinema 4D plugin, do mm-hmm. you have to have a standalone for each one individually, or can you have one standalone? And people were not sure about that. They're like, well, you could activate on each one individually and then deactivate the standalone, reactivate it on the other one, and then activate. I'm like, I don't think that works Ugh. That way.
Yeah, I don't think it works that way either.
Yeah.
I think you are required to have a standalone on everyone because I think it actually checks the standalone version
mm-hmm.
licensing or whatever.
And I believe that's correct. But then that it leads to the question, why is it more expensive to buy the 3-packs?
Yeah, I don't know.
Wouldn't you what get would a bulk be, discount?
I don't know. What would be interesting is that if they did it like V-Ray does it with Maya or Max, where you buy... No, I don't know if they do it like that.
Well, it would be nice to be able to just have a
where,
render node.
Where basically you've got three licenses, and then the standalone version is, you know, you own three licenses or whatever, if that makes sense at all. I don't think it does. Like, it references that one machine.
Yeah.
For the three licenses. Like a license server of some sort.
Of course. Like, if you wanted to do a render node, just uh-huh. a pure render node,
yeah.
or just have a dumb box with like stacks of 980s in it or something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, instead of having to buy a separate standalone, separate Cinema 4D for that machine, whatever it was.
Yeah,
but I don't know how I had it in here. I don't know where it went. But Otoy responded to you directly on Reddit this week.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah, well, because it was last week I posted on the subreddit that for those interested in Octane, that they pushed it back for another week. And mm-hmm. so do you have the post? What exactly they said? You know what? I'll find it real quick. I'm sorry. Just keep talking.
Yeah, basically...
Okay, Otoy pushed back Octane another week.
Yeah.
And so... someone said $75 for upgrade, but $620 for standalone plus plugin. Lol. And then someone said I must be missing the part that's funny. Blah, blah, blah. Anyway, the part where they make it cheap for people to upgrade, they can already afford in the first place, but don't make the standalone any cheaper for new users. And then Otoy commented on that one, saying we're adding flexible monthly subscription pricing in the coming months to help onboard users across a wider spectrum of budgets.
Right, and they're not talking about the ORC or whatever it's called. What is it called? The ORC?
I have no idea.
The online...
VDB? I don't know.
No, the online render deal.
Where you're paying like the cloud?
Not the cloud services.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. ORC, Octane Render Cloud.
Okay.
Yeah, not that. To me, it sounds like they're saying you're going to be able to pay monthly for Octane.
By the way, on Twitter, it says who to follow, and Budweiser is on our who to follow list.
That's funny. So, yeah, interesting.
I don't know. I really want Maxon to move to a monthly subscription thing.
Me too.
Gosh.
Okay, so somebody else mentioned about Octane insane preparing time on Reddit this week, and Sage was like... maybe BroGraph can chime in on this because I've never heard of this, but somebody said that if you're on a Mac, what did he say? He said, I would never use a Mac for Octane because calculation time is like 50% longer calculation time.
And I'm like, wait, really? Say that again? I've
heard about that. That the calculation time is twice as long on a Mac and something to do with the CPU.
I have never noticed that.
I've never noticed that.
I've worked on both PC and Mac, and I've never noticed that.
Right. And that's what I heard, too. And that was my whole thought. And when he brought it up, I said, I never heard of that. And the guy said, literally, the creator, I forget the guy's name, the a Oktar, whatever his name is on the Cinema 4D.
Oktar, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I forget his actual first name. I just know his screen name. He actually said something about that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's actually a link you can look at it that he linked to where he said specifically that the Mac has a longer calculation time, mm-hmm. up to 50%. And it's something I had never heard of before. And it made me think a little bit. Now, I still haven't had that much of an issue with calculation time, but you know, mm-hmm. this guy was basically saying, I have a 5 million polygon scene and it's taking a ridiculous time to load up. I said, well, first of all,
yeah, it's 5 million polygons.
5 million polygons is going to take a while. So he posted something that was like, you know, check it out, open it up and tell me what you think. When I opened it, and I don't know if he had changed it at this point, it was like 2.5 million polys. Or maybe it was tries. Really? Maybe that's why, because it was it's a tries. But so I looked at that and I was looking at his order of instancing. And this goes back to a tutorial that I posted about the correct way to instance when you're using Octane. Mm-hmm. There's a way that you can instance the wrong way and really like screw up your calculation time. So
yeah, because you can't instance an instance.
Right.
Right.
But you still have to choose which instance is the
better choice.
Right.
Yeah.
And so he had like all these spheres within each other and he had 2.5 million tries. And I think I was able to take it down to like 200 and something thousand
nice.
By switching his instancing. And I said, you got the order wrong in here. And now my calculation time, it wasn't, you know, 10 minutes like you said it was mm-hmm. a minute, and then when I switched your instancing it took maybe 10 seconds to calculate.
Yeah.
So but still that whole Mac thing, you know, he posted the link to it and I'm like now I'm curious. Now I want to see a PC side by side with a Mac and see what the calculation difference is.
Yeah, you know, I've maybe it's because my computer at work or at my old job was running 2970s or whatever, and I'm running a 980 Ti, 2 980 Ti's.
Mm,
but
that could be.
I mean, I never noticed any difference. My computer was always faster.
The thing is, if your scene is optimized
mm-hmm.
the way it needs to be,
yeah,
you know, unless you're doing something that has to have 10 million polys, when mm-hmm. are you ever going to hit that? You know,
yeah. Talk to Trevor Kerr.
Yeah, for real. What else we got here?
Okay, so I just did a quick Google
uh-huh.
search. So the Maxon blog in January of this year said something along the lines. Hold on, where is it? Additionally, for those who are using the industry standard. Oh, no, that's not it. Most significant change that has come to our industry is the shift from perpetual to subscription-based licensing. While Maxon remains committed to offering a perpetual license with the security of software ownership, we also recognize the subscription models make it easier for individuals to acquire software and for larger companies to adjust licensing counts to satisfy short-term production needs. Therefore, mm-hmm. in 2016, Maxon will be exploring new ways to offer Cinema 4D in a time-limited fashion to satisfy this demand.
Hmm.
So, who knows?
I bet you it's coming.
I know it's coming eventually. I would really love for it to be an R18, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So. Sorry.
What?
Funny tweet.
Oh.
Rob Delaney said, my wife is a total MILF. Mammal I've learned to fear. Anyway, go ahead.
All right. So, recording screencasts. This is something I was thinking about this week.
Okay.
Because I think we all do it differently, and I know a lot of people record screencasts yep. for different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
What is your workflow?
Mine is ScreenFlow.
Uh huh.
I use ScreenFlow. I record it. I edit it all in ScreenFlow.
Mm-hmm.
Because ScreenFlow's got some good tools.
Yeah.
Once you learn how to use them. It's not too bad.
It seems a little unstable to me.
It is.
I still record in it.
It totally is. Yeah, it's very unstable.
I like to record in it and just save the final, but here's what I've been trying to figure out, and I haven't had enough time to experiment with it, but it seems to me that, like, I always export, and I tell it to export to something that I can easily use that's not too big of a file, like some sort of H.264, mm-hmm. but a higher res, you know, lower compression, mm-hmm. so it still looks decent, has good resolution when I bring it into Premiere. Mm-hmm. But I wish that there was a way I could export it in its native codec.
Yeah.
Because anytime
like quickly.
Quickly. Because when you export in your native codec, then it just takes seconds as opposed to like, I mean, it will take an hour to export.
Yeah.
And it's like, I want to edit now.
I want it now.
And, you know, I record separately onto a GoPro.
Yeah.
And I sync it up. And it's a real easy process.
Why don't you use your webcam now? Now that you got it.
Now that I have it,
mm-hmm.
maybe, but I like the way the GoPro works in here because of the wide-angle lens. You can see my screens in the picture with me, and you can't do it with the other one as well.
Yeah.
I don't know. It works fairly well, and so I kind of do it that way. I know people have different methods, and I just thought I'd throw it out there, like, if anybody knows, because I'm trying to streamline the process, but mm-hmm. I don't like having to edit in a different editor.
Yeah.
You know, I like to work in Premiere, and I prefer working in Premiere, and I would like to be able to just export natively. I don't know.
ScreenFlow is not that hard, really.
No, it's not.
I mean, it's so convenient having everything already in sync, you know. Of course, you're working with GoPro footage with such. You should just use your webcam. I think you should just, that would be the easiest thing to do is just switch over to your webcam.
If I was bringing it into ScreenFlow.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if I was in Premiere, I'd still be recording that cam separately anyway. And I have all my stuff in there, and I have templates saved so I can just easily drag and drop things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the beginning, the end, the music, the promo stuff, it's pretty good, I guess, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So all that's, I don't know.
Anyway.
So, I wanted to talk about Gmail tips as our last subject.
Okay. You and David went over this.
Yeah, this is something that we were going to talk about on last week's show, but we had way too much to talk about last week.
Yeah.
And it was just a random topic that him and I just started talking about on Skype the other day, and he's like, oh, you should totally like do a tutorial on this or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know how you do your mail, but do you use the Gmail like interface, or do you use a mail program? What do you use?
I use Gmail. I just have Gmail open in my web browser.
Because that's what I do too.
And I've got a set amount of things that I have open all the time. One is Reddit, one is Gmail, and then Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
I've always got Twitter open.
And I think that you can, if you do tags, the tags will come through in your iPhone or mm-hmm. in whatever you use. Let's say mm-hmm. you use, I don't know, just regular Apple Mail, or you use Outlook, or whatever you use to like interface with Gmail. I think these tags come through, but I was talking to him about it the other day because I was sitting there going through my email like I mm-hmm. do, and the whole entire page was full of emails just from that day.
Yeah.
And we were talking about having to keep track of that stuff, and the way that I do it is I use filters and tags
mm-hmm.
for everything. So we started going through it, and he started using it too, and I thought I'd talk about that. So like if you're on a mail, like say you mail me something and you're my client.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say you are Joe Bob's Productions.
It's a good production name.
Yeah. And you email me something.
Mm-hmm.
I get a lot of mail, and it's all kind of coming through in just a big pile of garbage
mm-hmm.
with newsletters and all the other things. So I want it to stand out because you're my client.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to quickly be like, oh, glance at it and say, oh, there's something I really need to attend to because that's a client.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not just another Facebook tag or some other garbage that comes through, which I try to unsubscribe from religiously.
Mm-hmm.
But that stuff still comes through, and then other things come through. And so I will click on the email from mm-hmm. the person, and next to the reply button, there's that little button next to it, little drop down, and you can say filter messages like these. And when you mm-hmm. go on to that, it says, well, what do you mean by that? Do you mean from this particular person, or what is it? And usually it's from that person's email address or domain. Like if it's a company where I know a lot of people there and I'm interacting with a lot of different people at that one client, I'll just take their name out of the email address. In the email field, you can put joebobsproductioncompany.com. Mm-hmm. And I'll put that in there and I'll say, okay, go to next. Filter messages like these, and I'll say, create a new label for this person.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll create the new label. You can either, or you can add it to an existing label if you already have something, or you could do like child objects and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll say, give this the name Joe Bob's Production Company. And then when you do that, it creates it and it makes this little filter on the side. Mm-hmm. Well, when you get the filter on the side, then you can choose colors and you can do custom colors and all that. So I'll go in, mm-hmm. I'll choose a color that for some reason in my mind relates that company to, like, in my head to that color. So for example, if my client was Facebook, I would make it blue,
mm-hmm.
you know, something like that. Okay. And I try and make them all kind of different enough from each other to where I'm not using a lot of the same colors. And like for us, if it's something that comes to one of our addresses, it has a little Nexus tag with our colors on it.
Mm-hmm.
So I do that. Then on the side, you can say hide if unread,
mm-hmm.
which that's the really cool part, because then what you're doing is you're creating essentially this list on the left sidebar bar of your Gmail, and it will come up only if there's something to attend to. So all of a sudden, if you get like 5 clients that email you, mm-hmm. and they say they email you multiple times, on the left sidebar, that's when they'll pop up. And they'll say, you know, 5 things from this company, 1 thing from this company, another thing from this company. And all of a sudden you have like very important clients on the left sidebar. And if you click on them, then it brings up only their emails. And what's great about that too is if you have something that you do have to attend to with a client, mm-hmm. and you can't address it right then, you mark that email as unread and it's going to show back up on the sidebar as mm-hmm. as a client name with a number next to it. So it kind of keeps them in your head. It kind of keeps your client's needs like at the top of the list, because like, for example, tomorrow's Monday, and mm-hmm. I know that there's some things that came in last minute Friday, and I said, well, I'm not going to answer them today because it's already too late and I can't mm-hmm. attend to it today. I'm going to do it on Monday. I right-clicked. I said, mark as unread. And so now I have like 3 companies that first thing tomorrow morning, I know I need to get to them. Because if they just went through and I just read it, I might forget about them.
Mm-hmm.
And that sucks. And then you can embed, you know, child objects and stuff like that, which I do for BroGraph. Like I have mm-hmm. all the BroGraph stuff, and then BroGraph fans, and the plugin, and plugin bugs that come in from beta testers. All that, like, separate child objects.
Mm-hmm.
What I like to do, this is something I learned from Merlin Mann, is if I really need to be in an extra concentration mode,
mm-hmm.
you can create a Gmail label as null.
Mm-hmm.
And under null is nothing. So when you click on that, you have a Gmail window that opens with no mail in it.
Okay.
Okay, so the only things that come through are the things that are labels. And if you create that as the bookmarklet, as your inbox homepage, then you always see nothing. And only the important stuff will show up in that left sidebar. And all the other stuff, you can wait till later and go to your inbox and then sort through it.
That's pretty cool.
Only those things come through. So like, it's just one of those things where out of sight, out of mind, no distractions.
You should do a BroGraph talk on that.
I might do that.
Well, there
I might
you go.
Do that. So, a couple other random links. We talked about some of these already. The Simpsons last
week. Yes. Time.
Yeah, that was fun.
That was cool. Like, way to go, Adobe. That was that's awesome. I mean, I'm sure it was a terrible strain on the animator's wrists, but.
So, if you don't know what we're talking about,
the Simpsons ran a live segment, 3-minute segment. I believe they did an East Coast and a West Coast one. I've only seen the East Coast one, but basically they used Adobe Animator in order to have Homer talking and taking live calls that people were asking questions. So it was cool. And,
that's
you know,
cool.
In order to keep it, you know, fun and not just him sitting there talking, they use the feature in Animator where, like, you press a button and then it'll do a certain animation, mm-hmm. you know? So they had, you know, Bart running through, and then they had Bender from Futurama walk through and all this other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, so it kept it fun. And really what I think it was trying to do was distract you from the mouth movements, because that's the yeah. one thing that I've noticed with Animator is it still isn't one-to-one mm-hmm. for great mouth movements. They just haven't figured it out yet. It's like the dictation software that they're using is not quite perfect.
And it's still technically a beta program, isn't it? Or alpha or something?
Oh, I don't know.
There's parentheses next to it still.
It's a good program. From everything that I've seen, I've never actually had the chance to play around with it, but from what I've seen, it's so funny because, like, I take a lot of pride in Animator because, you know, I came up with the concept before they did, mm-hmm. you know, because, you know, I did that tutorial about syncing mouth movements with audio and stuff. Yeah. And I had come up with that years ago and posted that on my blog and even did a flash thing showing it off, mm-hmm. as well as being able to hit the space bar and then his arms move up while you're talking and stuff. So just want to point out that I came up with that first.
Flash.
Yeah. So I take
a little
bit
of pride. How
about
Shockwave? Did you do it in Shockwave too?
Shockwave. I believe they're the same thing, aren't they?
No, Shock. Well.
Yeah, I believe
they were like spawn-offs.
Shockwave
of
Flash.
Each other.
That's the way it originally was.
It was Shockwave Flash, but wasn't Shockwave its own thing first?
I don't know.
I found my Shockwave manual this weekend in the garage.
It's funny.
And my Avid water bottle from 1993. Oh, it's probably worth something.
Take that to NAB next year.
Yeah.
Anyway, so they ran a 3-minute segment live. You should check that out.
And I already talked about the already been chewed links, so you'll see those in the show notes.
Cool.
And then David told me about a new animation texturing site.
Okay.
It's called Polygon, but it's Poligon.
Polygon.
Yeah. And it's still in its infancy. Like, it's still a little bit limited, mm-hmm. but it has a limited trial thing you can do. So where you can get a whole bunch of stuff.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
This is awesome.
It's really awesome, but it's still young.
Yeah. The patterns by themselves. Oh my gosh. That's crazy.
So here's the thing, right? Yes. The hottest new texture site is polygon.com. This site has everything. Overlays, bumps, diffuses, reflections, displacements, normals. Yeah. It has all these things. It has all these things. And so, like, he's been trying it out. I was looking at it. What's really cool is, like, the scratches and stuff.
Yeah.
And fingerprints and things you can put on glass. You know, that's the kind of thing that nobody really has a good library of right now.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool.
This is cool. This is really cool. Okay, and how much does it cost?
I think I want to say it was like $160 a year.
Really?
I think so. $160 a year.
And so sign up and get an access to 30-day trial. You can download up to 10 daily photos for free.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, the scratches and stuff, that looks pretty good.
I mean, thumbprints
and
stuff.
Holy cow,
yeah.
Super, like, tree-lined tropical, like, yeah, tree lines and stuff like that. That is so rad.
But go to some of these regular textures and just look, because each one, you can click on it, and then you can say, like, show me just the diffuse, or just the displacement, or just the normals for this. Yeah. Like, you could just get one of those things if you only need one of them. Like, if you just need a displace for something.
Like, how these are, like, super high quality. That's nice.
It's just
look
limited.
At all the wood ones. Wow.
So it's like, you can tell, like, if this
Holy
picks
cow.
Up and they start
It's even
adding...
got the displacement ones?
Yeah,
and
you see what I'm saying?
That is crazy.
Yeah.
So nice. Good stuff. Cool. Okay. Cool. Yeah, polygon.com. Check it out.
So just a couple quick email social things. We love to get your email if you have anything you want to talk about. Mm-hmm. Topic ideas especially. We need some topic ideas, please. Please.
Yeah, because we're running a two-hour show. We'd like it to be three.
No. No, but I would like to have some more meat topics, you know, that kind of thing. So, send them in, and we just have some really quick updates. Some of them we already talked about. So, this is something I mentioned a while back, a couple episodes ago. Somebody was talking about like the fact that they had Octane and it was taking hours to render. Mm-hmm. And I said, really, what kind of car do you have? And they're like, and this week they finally responded and said, I have two 980s with 4 gigs of VRAM on SLI, which that doesn't really matter in this case. But
yeah, but don't you want to take it out of SLI?
That's what I hear, is they prefer you not use SLI, but I don't think it's makes that much of a difference. It says really slow render in Octane. It's real time to preview, but when I render full res, it takes forever, like 2 to 3 hours to get a clean picture. And then says, I work in animation. Octane was a bad idea. I'm like, I've never heard anybody say Octane was a bad idea.
Yeah.
Something can't be right. I was like, dude, send me, what do you have, like a 20 million polygon scene?
Yeah.
Are you rendering possibly in like not direct lighting mode, like one of the other two modes, and you're rendering like a crazy high samples?
Yeah. Maybe his preview is in direct lighting and he's going, I don't know. You wouldn't want to do that.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking something's not right. I'm trying to help, but I haven't really gotten...
How big is his scene?
That's what I'm saying.
Is his preview window, you know, I don't know, 640 by 480, and then you're rendering 1920 by 1080, 300 DPI?
Yeah, like DPI maybe. I don't know. Something's not right.
Yeah, I have ran into single frames 2 to 3 hours if I'm running path tracing at a super high sample rate.
Mm-hmm.
And
but on purpose.
Yeah, but on purpose.
You're rendering a still.
Yeah, I'm rendering a still frame.
Right.
But I don't know. But it would have been like 20 to 30 hours V-Ray or standard render.
Exactly.
So
I wish I knew more about it, but we'll see. And Edit Room on Vimeo actually brought up a great question, because he was watching the vector motion blur tutorial that we have out there talking about how to pull those different the alphas to really hone in that motion blur without getting weird edges or lines or anything, and said, well, what about if you have lots of different objects moving around in the scene and there is no alpha? How does that work? And my answer was that if you're doing a scene like that, what I like to do, if I have, like, let's say I have a room and I have, and it's basically not really moving much, but then I have a bunch of objects flying by in the scene, well, I'll object buffer those in order to use that as like the cut for those in the alpha, and I'll use a set mat so I can still do like chokes and all that kind of stuff in After Effects. Mm-hmm. And then I'll only apply the motion blur to that. So that was my answer for that.
Yeah.
We talked about Sarah and her stuff. She just finished watching the Intro to Materials tutorial. She's about to watch our lighting one. She said, thanks again for the info. And then Steven Emerson was talking about last week. We're talking about the video he did, the 360 video.
Yeah.
And said, thanks for the shout out. Glad Dave is enjoying the Oculus. I still haven't even tried my video in the DK2. He hasn't tried his own video.
That's funny.
And hashtag for shame. So,
for shame.
For shame.
Cool.
Yeah, dog.
2 hour show, like always.
Well, good, good. Anyway, we don't have any new reviews. Is that right?
No, no new reviews.
Dang, yo. We need to remember to ask at the beginning of the show.
Meh. Who cares? Meh. It's iTunes.
Right.
People don't even see us. They got to find us first.
Right. So rate us on iTunes. I guess leave a review if you can.
You know what? Here's the thing. I don't care about reviews. Tell your friends. Yep, that's all I want.
That's true.
Just tell your friends about the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
If you like podcasts, give us a shout out on Twitter or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, tell your friends about us.
Subscribe to us too on YouTube. You can find all that info on our website, on all our different social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, brograph.com. You can buy a t-shirt. No brograph, no mograph tee.
Yep.
Which is awesome.
Yep.
You should buy that. That supports
us. The softest t-shirt you'll ever wear in your life.
I don't know about the softest, but it's up there.
It's pretty soft.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, anything else?
No, I think that's it.
All right.
All right. Well, I guess until next time.
I'm Dave.
And I'm Matt.
Have a good one.
Later, bros.
Pretty good, I guess. Brograph.com, an online resource for learning critical components of Cinema 4D and After Effects, specifically catered to help you prevail as a motion graphic designer.
What's up, bros? Welcome to another Brograph motion graphics tutorial.
We give you professional time-saving tips, shortcuts, and lessons that help give you an edge over your fellow designers. Not only this, but our new Brograph Talks help you in your file management, hardware configuration, and client relations.
I love projects that scare me. When our art director comes to us and asks for something that I had never done before, man, it gets me pumped.
Join us for live sessions, check out our crazy Cinema 4D experiments, or just watch our Fun with Brograph series, where we show you practical applications for techniques learned in previous tutorials. Do this from the beginning, and your client is going to respect that, and they're going to respect you, and they're going to respect your time. Subscribe today and get automatic updates on the latest tutorials, tricks, tips, and inspiration brought to you by industry professionals Dave Koss and Matt Milstead, all with a slight dash of dry humor peppered in.
Real nice banana.
Brograph.com, your source for tutorials that will help you thrive in the motion graphics industry. Don't just play around with Cinema 4D and After Effects, master it, and make money by becoming indispensable at your workplace.
We don't care how you get here, folks, just get here!
Subscribe now to Brograph Tutorials.
It's pretty good, I guess.